As a child, how did you perceive plants?
Plants were my extended family.
Ah, yes.
I've been very blessed because I was born to a father who was a conservator of forests.
So he
protected the trees in the wild. And my mother, who was highly educated, chose to become a farmer. So when we would go to her farm, we would learn everything about farming. And this was in the pre-Green Revolution days. So when the harvest would come, we would peel the chickpea, we'd peel the mustard, save the seeds. And for us, the forest and the farm was such a celebration of life in partnership with plants, both cultivated and wild. And I think it's those early lessons that plants have given me that sustain me today in these big struggles against giant corporations. I think all the energies I've received from the plants in those many years and all the thought that comes in a tacit way. Because you can learn, I can learn quantum theory in a formal way, but there's so much knowledge that is not formal. That is part of the lived experience.
Right.
And so I say thank you to all the plants in my life.
Right, right. I have the feeling that plants themselves inspire us.
Yes, they do.
Yes.
Maybe I should mention one little other story. Yeah. So I was growing up innocently to be a physicist. And having grown up in the Himalayan forests, while I was doing my PhD in the foundations of quantum theory, I used to come back still to spend my vacations in the forest. And I saw the forest disappear. But a group of women started a beautiful movement called Chipko, which means to hug.
Right.
And I joined as a volunteer. Every holiday I would spend with them as a young student. And it's in Chipko. I learned everything about what the forest is to an ordinary peasant woman in India. How it is the source of the compost, the source of the fodder, of the fuel, of the water. The women taught the scientific establishment the lessons on ecological services of the forest. They said, you count the timber of those trees? That's not timber. That's the source of water, of soil, of pure air. Today, that's what scientists are talking. The women were ahead by 40 years. You know, I woke up to the issue of seed in two phases. One was the Green Revolution in Punjab had been given a Nobel Peace Prize.
Right.
Norman Borlaug got a Nobel Peace Prize.
Yes.
And yet in the 80s, Punjab was a land of war.
It was, that's right.
Indira Gandhi sent the army into
that's
the Golden Temple. In turn, her security killed her.
Exactly.
1984.
That's right.
And the same year, a month after her assassination, we had the Bhopal disaster with the pesticide planting.
Yes, yes.
And by the end of that year, I decided to look at what was this thing called the Green Revolution, which was so violent.
Right.
And it had been given a peace prize.
Oh, yeah.
And then in 1987, I was invited to a conference where the old chemical industry was now talking about controlling seed through patents, through genetic modification, through new trade treaties.
Yes,
the World Trade Organization
has
within it
an
intellectual property treaty turning seed into the property of the Monsantos of the world.
Oh, yes.
That's when I decided I was going to start saving seeds. I didn't know anything about it.
Uh-huh.
I've never been to a biology class.
Uh-huh.
I was trained in quantum physics.
Yes.
But I first taught myself and started to go to the villages, asked communities.
Yes.
And because I'd been involved in movements like the Chipko movement, I knew villagers.
Yes. Okay.
And we started to save seeds as community seed banks because we believe privatization of the seed is wrong. It must be saved as the commons. Today, Navdanya has set up more than 110 community seed banks. From where seeds are available to farmers for free. All they have to do is give back seed when they have extra. We have dealt with cyclones, with salt-tolerant seeds in our seed banks, the tsunami, the drought, floods, crop failure, and now in the areas where the BT cotton is pushing farmers to suicide, we've brought back old cotton varieties and we have a seed bank in the area of Vidarbha so that farmers can do organic farming. But just saving seeds by itself doesn't complete the cycle. We help farmers go organic because local seeds are very good with organic. Yes. It's with chemicals yes. they don't fit.
That's right.
But we don't need chemicals in farming.
Okay, right.
And finally, the farmers do want to be able to market some of their produce mm-hmm. to buy their clothing, send the children mm-hmm. to school, mm-hmm. have right. a little money for the bus.
Right.
And so we help them with mm-hmm. bringing the mm-hmm. seed mm-hmm. through the organic produce to the table. And mm-hmm. we close the cycle.
Yes.
And we tell people, if you eat biodiversity, you save biodiversity.
Well, that's very good. That's a good slogan. And it is also important that the seed is constantly being regrown, so it is vitalized by the sun and the earth.
And is adapting and all the time.
It is adapting all
yeah.
the time.
Yeah.
That's very important. Instead of just keeping it like the official seed banks.
Frozen. In Svalbard.
Yeah, right. What happens to the farmers who trust in the promises of these seed manipulators and corporations?
Well, in the first round, the farmers got angry, which is why in Punjab they took mm-hmm. to the gun.
Because it didn't pan out, it didn't come out.
They were promised wealth, they were promised prosperity.
Right.
And instead they got into debt.
They got into debt, yeah.
And in the initial stages it worked because there were subsidies.
Oh,
it all
right.
came for free.
Oh, that's right.
It was,
that's
you know, right. all these extra things you don't need, non-renewable seed, chemical fertilizers,
right.
it all came with subsidies.
Oh, okay.
The World Bank locked us into debt.
Oh, yes.
As a nation.
Yes.
But they locked the farmer into debt.
Yes.
And then they said no more subsidies.
Uh-huh.
And that's why in the 80s, in Punjab, we had the rise of terrorism and extremism. 30,000 people died.
I never realized that connection.
When the army squashed that extremism, the crisis hadn't got over.
Yeah.
And then the seed companies came in directly. Earlier they came via the World Bank. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now they came directly.
Oh, yeah.
And with World Trade Organization, they had a free market. Mm. They could invest and take over Indian companies, as a result of which we have seen, for example, cotton.
For example.
Seed disappear, where 95% of the cotton seed is now owned by Monsanto.
Right.
They've
taken
control over 60 Indian seed companies.
That's right.
So now the farmers are in deeper debt.
Mm-hmm.
And now it's not a public debt. Mm-hmm. Earlier it was public banks, so farmers could protest, could fight. Now it's private debt because the individual farmer is now a consumer.
Oh, yes.
Rather than a conservator of seed, a breeder of seed, a grower of seed.
Right,
he's a buyer of seed. And he is persuaded to take the seed by giving up his old seed.
Yes,
so yours
indeed.
Is inferior, yours is primitive.
That's right.
And therefore give it up. And you'll be a millionaire, nothing less than a millionaire.
That's right.
And farmers really believe it so, because advertising is so good.
Of course.
And they get into unpayable debt, and the day the agents of the seed and chemical companies come to collect the land, that day the farmer goes into the field, drinks a bottle of pesticide and ends his life. That's the fate of 270,000 Indian farmers. We are seeing an epidemic.
270,000, that's
it's
more than
a quarter of a million.
Yeah.
And this is in a little over a decade. And if this process of seed takeover and seed destruction wasn't to stop, we will see biodiversity disappear.
Right.
Like 1,500 varieties of cotton gone. BT cotton.
How many varieties
we
are gone?
We used to have 1,500 varieties of cotton.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like we used to have 200,000 varieties of rice. And the Green Revolution destroyed most. But through our work in seed saving, we have rescued about 3,000.
Right. Why are traditional seeds so important?
Traditional seeds are not outdated seeds. Traditional seeds are living seeds that have grown out of 10,000 years of adaptation, that have grown out of 10,000 years of human intelligence and breeding. Breeding for diversity, quality, resilience, not for chemical response. And a combination of millennia of nature's intelligence, because after all, those seeds were already there in nature and were selected for the qualities that suited human beings. As human beings, as human communities, seeds were bred for being tasty, delicious. Like our aromatic basmati. They were bred for nutrition. So our old ancient traditional seeds give the most nutritious crops. We went with the Green Revolution along a disturbing path, which was breed seeds for responding to chemicals. Mm-hmm. They were basically designed to be chemical factories.
Right.
As a result of which, you produced more commodities, but less food.
Mm.
And we can see the crisis today where only 2% of the grain being grown in the world, especially soya and corn, is being eaten by humans. The rest is being used for cars and animal feed. So the idea of more in this monoculture commodity paradigm and chemical paradigm is so misplaced because it's not cultivating food. Mm-hmm. We need to get back to food. We need to get back to seed. Traditional seeds are also very important because they're the only ones with resilience. They've been mm-hmm. bred for resilience, whereas the new seeds are highly vulnerable. Mm. They collapse in the face of one pest attack. They collapse in the face of one drought. Our seeds are bred for tolerance to drought, floods, mm-hmm. salt, mm-hmm. when the cyclones come. And the community seed banks that we have set up have been so useful to farmers after crises. We call these seeds of hope. Oh. After a cyclone, salt-tolerant seeds mm-hmm. can be planted. Mm-hmm. After the suicides, the open-pollinated cotton seeds are the only mm-hmm. ones that are not getting farmers into mm-hmm. debt. So seeds that are traditional are seeds of hope and seeds of life and seeds of freedom.
Wonderful. If nothing changes, how do you see our future?
If the corporations keep trying to control the seed yes. and through it the food,
certain
consequences are inevitable. We've already seen the early stages of it. 75% of all the biodiversity in agriculture had already been pushed to extinction in 1995 when the Leipzig Conference on Plant Genetic Resources of the United Nations took place. Mm-hmm. Since then, there's been far more erosion of diversity, and we need that diversity,
yes.
both for food security as well as for climate resilience. The second thing we will see is deeper tragedies for farmers. We've seen already 250,000 Indian farmers commit suicide. If seed continues to be controlled and the control gets deeper, we will see the small farmer finished forever. And only the small farmer looks after the earth and produces real food.
Right.
Others create war against the earth and give us poison. The third very big consequence of corporations controlling the seed will be that they will prevent the real knowledge and research about what these seeds are doing to the soil. For example, we did research on BT cotton that showed that 25% soil organisms had been killed in 4 years of BT cotton planting. Every time a good scientist does independent research, Arpad Putsai in UK, Seralini in France, they go after him as if it is a war to try and finish off independence in science. But without independence, scientific inquiry is not scientific anymore. It right. becomes corporate propaganda. Mm-hmm. And worse, because we won't know what's happening to our food, we won't know what's happening to our health. Mm-hmm. That is why the corporations are fighting so hard, for example, in the United States, to deny citizens the right to know by denying labeling. A little labeling law in California was killed by millions of dollars being poured every day in false advertising in order to block labeling. Mm. Now, the right to know what you're eating is fundamental to democracy. It's fundamental to life.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that is why food democracy has all these dimensions, farmers having seed, being able to grow their food on their own terms and on the terms of the earth, scientists being free and consumers being free. All these freedoms will be destroyed. Mm-hmm. And with it, life on earth, because even though these corporations are trying to take control, they can't do the work that biodiversity does for us.
Right.
They can't do the work the small farmers have done. They can't do the work that organic does. Mm-hmm. They can create disasters, and then there will be a collapse. We've already seen how the BT cotton has created super pests, how the Roundup Ready soya has created super weeds.
Right.
They are playing with primitive, failed crude technologies and telling us we have technological miracles, hand over power to us. It is time for us to say no. You, all you know is how to perpetuate war. You came out of war, you're continuing war. We want this war to stop. We will be free and the seed will be free.
And what are your immediate goals?
Well, our concrete plans right now are, of course, to increase the farmers' networks for seed saving. But we've done this hand in hand with saying no to laws that make seed the patented property of corporations. And when we started Navdanya, we followed Gandhi. Like Gandhi had walked to the beach, picked up the salt when the British were making salt making illegal for Indians. He said, nature gives it for free. We need it for our survival. We will continue to make salt. We will not obey your law. And we do the same with seed. That nature has given it. Our ancestors have bred it.
Right.
We owe it to future generations to protect it in its vitality, richness, biodiversity. And we are not going to obey any law that criminalizes this duty of ours to the earth and future generations. This year, in 2012, we've given a call globally. Because in Europe now, there are new laws, seed laws, criminalizing farmers' own varieties, criminalizing diversity through these silly things called the register and compulsory registration of seed, as if your local seed handed over of thousands of years is going to harm anybody. And they're treating the local seed as what needs to be banned rather than the GMO seed, which actually should be banned. So we're giving a call for a global non-cooperation and a global seed saving. We hope that every farm and every garden will become a seed sanctuary. Because what is a garden worth it if it's buying the seed? Then it's not complete in its gardening, where you're giving back to the earth. So we're calling for a million gardens and a million seed sanctuaries.
You're talking into my conscience. What can every single person do to help achieve these goals?
I think if you're a gardener or a farmer, then the first step you have to take is make sure the seed you use is open pollinated, so that you can save it year in, year in and year out. If you can also be a seed breeder, it doesn't take too much. It just means watching the plant, seeing the best, selecting, seeing how a different climate, a different disease, some of the plants could do better. The second thing every one of us can do is adopt a seed. Even in your balcony, even if you don't have a garden, a little pot with your favorite plant. Just say, I'm committed to the future.
That's very good.
And finally, all of us eat. I think it is time for our eating to be a vote for life and diversity rather than for monocultures and destruction and disease. We have to eat organic. We must eat local. And our seeds must also be organic now.
Very good. Thank you.